can rent her apartment out to someone else. Right now, we're using her apartment there. So, all right, well, praise God. God can use every one of us. How many know that God can use every one of us? He sure can. He can use everyone. That way, if you're 5 years old to, you know, 105, God can use every one of us for his purposes, for advancing his kingdom. And one of the, no matter what the circumstances too, and I just wanted to share this before we get to this scripture reading in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. But there was a famous British actress, her name was Fanny Kemble. And she moved to the Americas in the early 1800s and married a southern plantation owner named Pierce Butler. Fanny enjoyed the life afforded by the wealth of the plantation until she saw the cost of that luxury. A cost paid by the slaves who worked her husband's plantation. Having written a memoir of the cruel treatment slaves often suffered, Kemble was eventually divorced from her husband. Her writings were widely circulated among the abolitionists and published in 1863 as Journal of a Residence on a Georgian Plantation in 1838 to 1839. But because of her opposition to slavery, the former wife of a slave owner became known as the unlikely abolitionist. You see, you know, we never know how God will use us to go against some kind of injustice, to go against something that was wrong. And we know that in God's eyes, we're all created equal. God is a respecter of no persons. And in God's eyes, he doesn't see what our skin color is, what we look like, how tall we are, how short, no matter what. God sees the heart. And that's so true. And here is a woman, Fanny Kemble, who stood up for these African-American slaves that were abused and victims of, unfortunately, some bad circumstances. But in the body of Christ, God often wonderfully surprises us. He regularly uses the unlikely people and circumstances to accomplish his purposes. Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 26 through 31, this to the church in Corinth. For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised God has chosen. And the things which are not to bring to nothing the things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. But of him you are in Christ Jesus, who became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that as it is written, he who glories, let him glory in the Lord. Let us pray. Father God in heaven, you are an awesome God. We thank you for your presence here this morning. We thank you for your Holy Spirit that convicts us of sin, righteousness, and of judgment. We thank you that we have a life more abundantly because of your Savior, your Son, Jesus Christ, the Lord and Lord and King of Kings. And we thank you that we can be here together to not keep our eyes on me, on this building, or anybody else, but to keep our eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. And Father, use me to speak as an oracle of God. And we pray this all in the name of Yeshua, Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the things the wise. God chose the weak things of the world, put to shame the things which are mighty. You know, Gene Brown in Danbury, Connecticut, said in the News Times that fool proof systems don't take into account the ingenuity of fools. Sometimes, you know, the word talks about earlier about being a fool and, you know, the foolish things. And you know, the world thinks, many Christians, you and I, that we're fools, that we believe there's a God, a creator. That we believe that we didn't came from monkeys, that we didn't believe that we were evolved from a Big Bang theory. People think we're foolish to be in church, we're foolish to believe in something that they don't believe exists. But I say, you can't get something from nothing. I say, there's a creator, designer, who gave us intelligence, who gave us wisdom through the Word of God. He spoke it into existence. He spoke and created everything around us. He knew us in our mother's womb. Our DNA is he perfectly created and designed every part of that aspect of our DNA, every chromosome, every molecule, every protein. God understands and knows everything. I recently shared on YouTube, I found this, not on YouTube, on Facebook, but it was a YouTube video, and showed the characteristics or dimensions and perspective of many of the other other the planets in our solar system and showed, you know, the moon, the earth, and just kept going Saturn, Jupiter, the sun. And then it was showing some of the biggest solar system suns and other planets. I mean, they were just millions and millions of times bigger than the earth. And it kept going and going. The expanse, it's beyond what we could even fathom in our little cranial cavities, how big the universe is. And I say to myself, how in the world could anybody think that this just happened to come up just like that, of a Big Bang Theory, or we evolved? I say, where are the transitions, the evidence that there is any type of transitional state from a monkey or an ape to a human? There is none. It makes that whole theory false and discarded. And that's why we have to, and we realize that there has to be a creator, a designer of the universe. And I would rather be a fool for Jesus Christ than a fool for this world. They can call me foolish, they can call me Pastor Bigger, they call me Pastor Intolerant, they call me all kinds of names that I don't even want to share in here. But I know whose child I am and whose name I bear. I know that God created us in His image and likeness. And yes, because of sin, there's fallacies, there's problems with mankind. We see the wars, we see the rumors, we see the problems that exist, and it all goes back to the time of Adam and Eve and the fall from grace, the fall from that perfect union with the Lord. But today, we face these problems and we realize that the world thinks we're foolish. And I say, let them think that, because the world is looking for peace and they're not finding it. The world is looking for all kinds of answers. They're sending men to the moon. They want to send people on a one-way trip to Mars and never come back, when all they have to do is open the Bible and we can find all the answers of creation. We can find all the answers of how God designed us. We can find answers to medical, physiological, spiritual needs, all kinds of different needs, historical needs, everything we want to know about the creation, about God's existence, what sin is about, what love is about. We can only look to the Word of God and we can receive His love. I don't look to the Quran. I don't look to other places. I want to be focused on what God wants for my life. And God can use every one of us. Every church and every believer needs to take the message of this passage to heart. For one of the most tragic characteristics of modern society is its pride and self-sufficiency. Modern society proclaims a doctrine of humanistic philosophy. That is, that man is supreme. And the result is a world that is about to explode under pressures of self must be pleased above all else. One has the right to do his own thing. Self-image brings wholeness. They owe me, or someone might say, might makes right, or color and race determine status. Well, the world is crying out and is in need for man to see the only answer to division is reconciliation with God. Reconciled. To come back and be restored to that perfect walk. But it requires a person to be humble. It requires a person to be willing to be renewed and be transformed in our minds by the Word of God. I listen many times to sometimes the different evangelical channels, and I listen to some of the preaching, and I ask myself, why is there not preaching the Word of truth? Why are they preaching another gospel? Why are they preaching a feel-good message? Why? Why don't they talk about, yes, there's greatness, there's goodness in God, there's wonder, there's peace, there's joy beyond measure. We are touched by the Holy Spirit presence, where we're even led to tears because we're so overwhelmed by the power of God and the love that we receive, and to know that we are saved, to know that we have a mansion in heaven, to know that I will leave this body and we will leave the body in the grave and we will go and meet the Lord and we will be forever in the presence of God. And it amazes me. World will deny Jesus. They will deny Him. And you can't even mention the name of Jesus. You know, people have a general terminology, a general thing of God. Oh, yeah, well, God, yeah, oh, there's a God. Oh, there's a God here. There's everyone thinks they know God. But do they really know God? Do they really know the God of the Bible? The God that given us His 40 authors and 66 books combined for us to have revelation, revealed truths, revealed wisdom. I'd rather be a fool for Christ than a fool for this world, as I said earlier. People don't understand because they are spiritually discerned. Apostle Paul wrote about that earlier in 1 Corinthians, in Romans. And again, they're without excuse because the attributes of God are clearly seen all around us. And we see the reason. Because we know in our consciences, which is the knowledge of good and evil, because of sin, we know what sin is. We know what it is to disobey mom and dad when we're a child, like Brandon. But we understand that there's consequences of sin, of the mistakes that we make. And that's why, just as much as I become tired and irritable, like the other day when Mariana was cleaning the home, and I just wanted to get out of that home, and I wanted to just go home. I was getting hungry, and I get hungry, boy. I sometimes get irritable, and I'm not a good person to be around, because I want to eat. I want some good old, some fried chicken, some black-eyed peas, some grits. Well, I'll tell you now. But anyway, I've been down in Kentucky too long, I think. But anyway, I just love it. So, you know, and I'm saying, come on, hey, let's go. And sometimes you act like the fool in a worldly stand. And Mariana, of course, she quickly straightened. She may be small, but she, watch out. She got that big machete, and I ain't going to mess with her. So I'm just kidding, honey. I know she don't like me when I say that, but I just love my wife. She's such a dear heart. She works hard. But, you get upset, and you realize in your conscience later, when you have the Holy Spirit shows you and reveals to you that, oh, Bob, you're putting your foot in your mouth again. Why don't you just zip your mouth and be quiet and just do what you got to do? It's kind of like when we go to the mall or someplace and we pass by a shoe place or there's shoes there. I always try to leave Mariana away from those places. Oh, look over here, honey. Look at this over here. Because I know she loves to go shopping for them shoes, and I just have to be patient and just wait until she may buy a shoe after 2 hours. We'll see what happens. But anyway, sorry to pick on you, honey. I'll probably hear about it later. But anyway, but you just sometimes got to be patient. We know, what I'm trying to say is, we know we have sinned. We know in our consciousness we can be patient or impatient. We can lie or we not lie. We can run from God or we can run to God. We can allow the wisdom of men and the philosophy of men to teach us, or we can have the wisdom of God in Jesus Christ to teach us and allow the Holy Spirit to lead us. And so we know that we are saved. We know, and we're not blinded, because the foolish things of the world put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world. How many times have God chosen some of the people that you would never imagine in your mind, and that person would be saved, and God used them greatly? I've seen people that were bikers that were, they were seriously just so evil in their nature and in their physical flesh. But all of a sudden, God grabs a hold of their heart and just twists and turns and pounds on them a few times and just changes them inside out. And man, they're just up there preaching. And people get their first impression. They see this guy with a leather jacket and biker and maybe this and that. And they think, oh man, this guy looks pretty rough, maybe tattoos or whatever. We're quickly to judge. We're quickly to look at the person and get the wrong impression. But then all of a sudden, they open their mouth. And they just share an amazing testimony. They're preaching. They love Jesus. They're hungry and thirsty for the things of God. And you are saying, wow, was I wrong about that man? Because my first impression was, says, look at this. Oh, I can't believe that man would come in that church dressed like that. And right away, after we're like convicted in this cranial cavity, like in your heart and your conscience, like, oh boy, I need to repent. Because who am I to point my finger? The world is bad enough that it points the fingers at us and tells us we're fools, and they just even come to the point where we even hate Christians and will be persecuted. And the Bible says these times will come, and if they are not now, which they are, by ISIS and other groups that hate the name of Christ, hate the name of, we follow Jesus, and we say that he's the only way, the truth, and the life. So these times are upon us, and we must be ready. Yes, they call us foolish. Yes, they call fool, or they think we're crazy, or who knows what, or Bible-thumping preachers and ministers and people who live like that. Well, praise God. You know, I remember when I was before and I wasn't saved and I was a Roman Catholic and, you know, I didn't know much about God. I just went to church and thought I was all set and good to go. And I used to even talk about them Southern Baptist people. Oh, yeah, that's them crazy people. All the women were always wearing dresses and hats and they do weird things and they do all kinds of crazy things. And I'd say, well, what a bunch of foolish people. Well, lo and behold, here I am. Talk about circumstances. Talk about God doing His will. You never know how God's going to turn something around and put you in a place where you're going to say, uh-oh, I put my foot in my mouth about a few years ago, didn't I? God is in the business of changing hearts, changing the mindset, renewing us, transforming us, reconciling us, restoring us into that authentic Christian relationship with God through one Savior, one Lord, one hope, Jesus Christ. Oh, glory to God. I'm getting excited for Jesus. I'm going to start dancing again. Hallelujah, Jesus. Whew, hallelujah. I just love the Lord because I get excited because I know He's going to do great things. When we go forward and take that step of faith, God's already taken steps in front of us. He's already opening doors. We've got to get out of the comfort zones, get out there and reach the lost that are lost, that don't see, that think we're fools. And all of a sudden, they're going to be changed. And they're going to realize, yes, I've got something that they had, and I want it, and they get excited for the Lord, and then they're just sealed by the Holy Spirit. A promise, as Apostle Paul talks about, they're saved, and no matter what the world thinks of you, let them think I'm foolish. You know, people, kids, teenagers going to college, high school, you know, they're going to go to college, and that's a critical time in their lives. Big parties, have fun, fornicate, don't worry about it, have fun, you'll lie to the devil. For the Christian to abstain and to be pure and try to live the holy life, it's a hard thing. It's hard enough for us adults to do that. Every day we're confronted by the lies of the devil. Deception, trying to doubt our faith, trying to lead us astray. Not this guy. Not in my household. As for me and my household, we shall serve the Lord. We shall walk in truth and spirit. We shall devote ourselves every day, because when you open that Word of God, boy, oh, them devil don't like that. He don't like to hear that word. Because the word is powerful. It cuts and divides bone and marrow, soul and spirit. And it gets right to the heart. And it tells you like it is what it is. And that's what the truth does. It sets you free from this world system. Yes, God can use every one of us. God desires a willing heart ready to be used. Romans 2:11 says, for there's no partiality with God. He's a respecter of no persons. Don't even think that God can't use you just because you're maybe 89 or 90 or 102 or 6 years old. God can use every one of us if we're willing to go forward and willing to pray and let Him speak to us. Let Him speak to our hearts. He does not call many outstanding people, and that's so true. Think about this. Even Billy Graham, Spurgeon, D.L. Moody, George Whitefield, Jonathan Edwards, so many of the great people that were famous for their preaching and ministering God's word to the people, they all started at one point in their lives where they needed to grow and learn. It might have been a good Sunday school class. It might have been someone mentoring them. But they all came to a point in their lives where they said, you know, God has called me to a calling. God has given us gifts. And when we combine and we're mixing our faith with the gifts in the Holy Spirit, and we're just getting this whole thing put together, and all of a sudden, you're equipped. You're equipped to do the ministry of God, to perform ministry of reconciliation that we all are charged to do by Apostle Paul in Romans and in 1 Corinthians. Talks about that. Talks about the abilities. No matter what circumstances we're in, no matter what, Apostle Paul was in prison, but yet he wrote letters and epistles that we are studying today. His handwritten notes, his letters. We have it. We're reading his email, basically. We have the ability to do just as he did, no matter what circumstances we may be in. One day, who knows where God will lead us and take us. But the question is, are we ready? Are we ready to do what God's called us to do? See, many times people, when they get confronted with issues and problems, oh, they want to run away. It's not the time to run away. It's a time to run to each other, to work with each other, to forgive, and to say, you know, we can't live a divided and live a divided life. Our nation is divided. Why? Because of selfish pride, power of sin and the control upon lives, to control, manipulate, to be selfish. I say the church needs to grow up once again and start getting into the meat. Start saying, Lord, we can't change the past, but Lord God. You know, my old expression, I'll say it again, you know, I don't know what tomorrow brings, but I know who brings tomorrow. I know who brings tomorrow. And I know God can use every one of us together for great goodness things. We don't want to be fools. You know the word fool in the Bible, you know what the Greek word is? It's moros. You know where we get the one word moros from? We get the English word moron. I don't want to be a moron. I want to be foolish for the Lord, yes, I want to do His will, but I don't want to be stupid and moron and moros. I want to be a full of the Holy Spirit, of the knowledge of God's Word, so I can give the answer to the hope that I have, and I will be able to teach and raise others. I want to plant another church. I want to plant more seeds all up there for the world. I want to go meet my community leaders. Now that I move here, there's no excuse. I'm going to go do that and get out there and reach these people for the kingdom of God. Because I'm excited, because I know what God did for me. He took me out of the world, this world system that's full of so much problems. And He's brought me into the kingdom of God, where I have power, boldness. I can stand up here sober and full of the Holy Spirit of God, and I can proclaim the good news, because I know I was transformed from such a filthy, disgusting person. But I stand here washed by the blood of Jesus. Yes, I said the blood. Yes, I said sin. But Lord, we have such joy now that when we are born again from above, born by the power of the Holy Ghost, when we're convicted of our sin and we realize, man, I'm never going to achieve to be good in my own strength in the eyes of God. I'll never appease my Lord unless I first get on my knees. Get on my knees and say, Lord God, forgive me. I'm a sinner. I need your Lord. When you realize how much you've fallen short of God's glory, and you come to the point and say, will I serve the world and make the world happy and yet be part of them? Or will I get on my knees and say, Lord, I want to be separate from the world. I want to work on your kingdom, because I know this world is just temporary. It's like a vapor. But your kingdom will be forever. And I want to serve you, Lord. I just want to, because I know when I get to heaven, you're going to know me, because I'm in that intimate relationship with you, Lord. And I see everything in a different perspective. Yes, God looks at the heart, not our appearance. Think about David, Jesse's son, the youngest of eight boys, right? Eight children. Samuel comes to look for the next king of Israel. And he looks at the seven of them, goes through them all and says, Samuel said to Jesse, hey, it's none of these. And he says, oh, but David, well, it's little David. He's the youngest. He's out there taking care of the sheep out, the flock out there. Bring him in here. Samuel says, that's the one. See, it was sad that David's own father, Jesse, would not even consider. I was thinking about this when I was looking at the word. I said, wow, his own dad just kind of dissed, or just like said, well, that's just David. He's not going to be no king. But you see, God had a different plan, didn't he? David's going to be a great man. David's going to be a man after God's own heart. Oh, but boy, did David make some mistakes? He sure did. But he repented over it. He repented. He said, I'm sorry, God. He made some serious mistakes. Fornicated and had a man killed, Uriah. But he went to the Lord in forgiveness. That's the heart of a true man and woman. Willing to forgive, willing to say, I'm sorry. The world wants you to be full of pride and you know best, and I don't need God. I don't need all these things. I don't need church. That's what the world says. And more people are walking away from church. So sad. We need the youth. We need your youth. We need the youth to say, look, I'm standing up for Jesus. The world may want a party, and they think they're going to go to hell and have a great party there, but it's not. The world needs the youth. The world needs the youth to come up and rise up and to realize that there is a Creator and that He loves us. Today, in Christ Jesus, He became for us wisdom from God and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. He did it for us. When you have Jesus, you have it all. When you have the Lord and you make Him Lord of your life, that's when you die to yourself, you die to this world. The world says you're a fool, but God says you're my son or my daughter. Today, take the humble response, take the humble way. Realize our calling is not based upon ourselves, but of God's wisdom. What the world may call foolishness, God calls it wisdom. And our wisdom comes from God, who is the source. And today I ask you to plug into God. Word is truth. Plug into prayer. Plug into a walk of faith. Believe me, the world's gone crazy out there. And we know it. We see it. But God wants us to be His children in a mighty way. He's got a lot of great plans for all of us. We just got to hear from Him. We got to be listening to the voice of God. We can get so caught up in the world around us. We're bombarded on the internet. We're bombarded on the television. We're bombarded on the streets with all kinds of noise pollution and sign pollution, all kinds of pollution trying to just engross us with everything else but God. And I remember that movie with John Denver. It was about, He was playing, God came to him. I forgot his name, the actor. But I remember the slogan, they was going around making bumpers. It says, thank God. I like that. I said, thank God. So when we come through our lives, we've got to thank God as well in all we do. You know, in my life, I never thought I would be where I am today. Never. I thought I was going to be the next Jimi Hendrix, Stevie Ray Vaughan, this great famous rock and roller playing guitar. And I was on my way to that. And the devil was giving me the highway to hell. But it was God made a change of plan. He had a bigger plan for my life. I don't regret anything of leaving that world and coming to the kingdom of God. I don't regret it in anything. God allowed me to go through many things in my life, many circumstances, and He allows us to go through them. And we learn from them. We learn from our mistakes. But today, if you want to be in God's kingdom, we must humble ourselves. We must admit we're sinners. We must believe in the precious cross and the blood of Christ. He alone will wash away your sin. He alone will remember them no more as far as the east is from the west. But you must come to the crossroads. I can't push you. No one else can. Your neighbor can't. CNN can't save you. Jesus Christ alone can save you if you're willing to bow down and humbly come to Him. Come to the altar. Come to the throne room of grace. And that grace is sufficient in time of need. Let us pray. Father, we know no matter what circumstances we are in, God can use every one of us. And Father, our calling is a sure calling based on a sure foundation. Lord, you have given us a privilege, and yet even eternal life if we admit our faults to you, Lord, our sins. And if we believe, the Bible says, you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe that God raised from the dead, the Bible says you will be saved. The Bible says, for whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And today, if you have not called upon Jesus, if you have not trusted Him with your whole heart, your mind, your body, soul, if you have not come to the place where you need to get on your knees, or you need to come today and come to receive the gift of eternal life, the devil's going to try to prod you away, to distract you, to mislead you and say, in doubt, and try to not be ashamed of God. But the Holy Spirit's saying, come, and I will give you rest today. I will give you salvation, and you will know you have eternal life. That's what Apostle John said. Father, we love you, we thank you, and we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. If you don't know Christ as Lord and Savior, please come forward. We will pray with you for any kind of prayer needs. Healing or issues in your life, you're facing problems. We continue believing. We continue believing for healing. We continue believing that God's will be done. Continue to help us get through this journey of life.
Our invitation hymn, hymn number 275, let us stand as we sing.
Come forward if you need prayer. We will gladly pray for you. Come now and get saved and know you have eternal life.
All to Jesus I surrender, all to Him I freely give.
Come as you are.
I will ever love and trust Him in His presence daily live. I surrender all.
Do you surrender all?
I surrender all. Oh, to Thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender. Make me Savior, holy thine.
Amen.
Let me feel thy Holy Spirit, truly know that thou art mine. I surrender all. I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender, Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessings fall.